Good morning, everyone. Good to have you all worshiping with us this morning. If you're joining us online, thank you for joining us for time of worship. We pray that the Lord would encourage us and bless us this morning as we bring our hearts and our minds to Him. We're excited today to start a new sermon series in the book of Genesis. And you know, with everything going on in the world and all the changes that are happening all the time, it's important for us to be reminded of a God who never changes, who has existed from everlasting to everlasting, and His truth never changes, and we can hold to a God that we know who will and always be the same, who is and will always be the same. And so Genesis teaches us so much about life and the foundations of who we are and who God made us to be, and we need to be reminded of that in the midst of everything that's changing around us. Amen. And so we're excited about that, and as we look to our Creator God and who He is. As we think about that, I want us to turn to John 1 to start our time together. And we'd like to read a passage of Scripture to start our service that's related to the passage that we're going to be preaching on later on in the service. And so John 1 tells us from the New Testament about creation and about our Savior who was there at creation. So John 1, starting in verse 1, says this: "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were created through Him, and apart from Him, not one thing was created that has been created. In Him was life, and that life was the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, and yet the darkness did not overcome it." Of course, we know that this is how Jesus is introduced to us by John, and tells us that Jesus was there at creation, the triune God, and all things were created through Him. And so we're going to be looking this morning at how God is introduced to us in the Bible, and so much about what it teaches us about who God is, not only out there, but who God is for us, and who God wants us to understand Him to be. So let's go to the Lord and pray together. Father, we come before You. We are humbled as we think of You as Creator. Lord, we are Your creation. You have made us. Our lives are dependent on You. You are the author of all life. You are the author of our lives. And we praise You that You have made us. And we look to You as the standard for our lives. Nothing and no one else compares to You, and You are worthy of our worship. And so we pray that You would be worshipped today, that You would be glorified. And we pray that You would help us to align our lives to You and who You've made us to be, that we would leave today with a clearer understanding of who You are and who we are before You, and that we would live each day with that reality, that we would look to You, seeing our need for You, and that You would sustain us, that You would give us the life that we were meant to have under You. So God, be glorified in us today through our praises, through our prayers, through our songs, through our study of Your Word. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you're here with us this morning, please stand as we sing "Holy, Holy, Holy." If you're joining us online, join with us as we sing this great hymn, "Holy, Holy, Holy."
Thank you.
Actually, the tune was called Nicaea. It is called Nicaea. It was written as a tribute to the Council of Nicaea that met in AD 325 to combat heresies, and that was about the Trinity. That's where they started to formulate that doctrine of the Trinity. So, awesome song, great hymnody there. Turn with me to the beginning of your Bibles, Genesis chapter 1, starting in verse 1, and let's hear God speak through his perfect
and holy word this morning from Genesis chapter 1, starting in verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness covered the surface of the watery depths, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for your eternal word, perfect word. Something that we can always look to in time of need. No matter what's going on around us, we know that your word is truth. And we can always go back to it when we need guidance, when we need clarity, when we need wisdom. And Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit this morning, clarify your word. Change hearts and minds. Draw us closer to you. Keep us from following our own desires and our own muddled eyesight of what's going on around us. Let us see you working through your creation. Eternal, uncreated God. You created everything. And you were there. And you planned out everything just the way that it is. And you have given us a hope in eternal things through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Right, if you have your Bibles, leave them open to Genesis 1, just those first two verses, and there's plenty there.
And so I'm
looking forward to just unpacking those two verses and the implications of these verses for our lives. How many of you all, a couple months ago, were able to watch the SpaceX space shuttle launch? I know if you were like us, our whole family was kind of around the TV. For our kids, it was something new, right? There hadn't been a launch in a while. And so they were excited to see it kind of for the first time in person themselves. And so we were excited to watch it with them. Dana's parents came over, and so we had made a kind of an evening of it. But I want to take us back a little bit further to when space shuttles were kind of first going up. In Christmas 1968, may seem like a long time ago to some of you, but Apollo 8 was orbiting the moon for the first time. And so no humans at that point had ever been so far from the Earth, had never seen the Earth rising in the distance like it was at that point. And as the world was watching on TV, just captivated by what they were seeing, the space crew were in awe. And as they were on live broadcast, here's what they said. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the Earth. And they went on to quote the first 10 verses of Genesis on live TV. And here was people experiencing the vastness of creation, of the universe, the grand display of the universe, seeing the earth that God had created, and they were hearing how God introduced himself, how the maker of all these things introduces himself to us in the Bible. And that's what we're going to focus on today and over the next few months as we go back to where we came from and get a better understanding of who we are, knowing what God has made us to be. The beginning of the Bible in the book of Genesis tells us about the beginning of the universe and gives us, as a result, a fundamental understanding of who we are.
Amen.
Tells us who God has made us to be, where we come from, and why we exist. Maybe you have wondered, why am I here? Why? How did I get here? How did human beings come to exist on this earth? Why did God make us? Why is life such a mixture of happiness and tragedy, fulfillment and frustration. What is the good life? And where can I find it? How can I live my best life now? Even though my best life isn't now. But how can I live the most that God wants me to live? Most importantly, we find that Genesis introduces us to God. Not just as a distant being, but as a clear and personal being. That's what we find in Genesis, a God who is real and personal. And so that's what I want us to see. If you're taking notes, the main idea of this passage today, as we look at the very beginning of the Bible, is this. Creation reveals that God is the ultimate reality. And He should be central to everything about your life. Creation reveals, first and foremost, that God is the ultimate reality in all of life. And as the ultimate reality, as the starting point of everything, He must be central to your life. That is how He designed you. So let's start at the beginning. Let's start at the beginning of what God has made things to be. And knowing that God is before all, and He is the one who created all. So first thing we see, first point is this. God is before all. He sets the standard for life. Verse 1. So that's what we're going to see. Christians believe that everything that exists traces its origin back to God. He is the maker of all things. Look at verse 1. In the beginning, God. Just those four simple words mean a lot. First, we find and see that there was a beginning. Life has not always existed as we know it. And so everything that follows explains life, how it began, who was behind it, who holds it together. It didn't just happen randomly. There was a starting point, and someone had to start it. And He holds the explanation for everything in it. And if we miss that, we will miss so much about what we can know about life. So there was a beginning, but also in those four words, we see that God was there in the beginning. He is eternal. He has existed from eternity past to eternity future. God is, in other words, infinite. God is not bound by anything. God is independent. He doesn't rely on anything else. He was there before there was anything else. And so God is not dependent on you or me or anything for His existence. He is above us all, above all things. So this tells us that everything starts with this one God who creates all things out of nothing by Himself. Isaiah 44:24 says it in this way. God stretched out the heavens by Himself. No one was with Him. He took counsel with no one, not even the angels. God didn't need anything or anyone to create. He is that powerful, that big, that mighty. And so here is a big implication for our lives, for you and me today. The fact that in the beginning, God, means that life begins with God. Your life doesn't begin with you. God begins your life. Because God is pre-existent and He created, He is the standard for you, for everything else, and how it is measured. If you think your life is good, that's your thought. You need to go to what God says. He is the standard to determine those things. He's the standard to determine what is good, what is bad, what life's purpose is, how you should live your life, how you should not live your life. God determines all these because He made all things. Without God, there is no standard. There is no purpose that we can point to. Everything is subjective. Morals, what's right, what's wrong, what people say or think and whether that's right or wrong. Everything is up to opinion. And who's to say that you're right and I'm wrong, or vice versa. Even atheists, an atheist is somebody who does not believe in God, but even atheists recognize that without God, there is no definitive right and wrong. And they are on shaky ground when they try to tell somebody that what they're doing is wrong. We see in our world today what happens when there is confusion over right and wrong, don't we? Just turn on the news today, and you will see varying opinions on how things should be, what people should be doing, how people should be responding, how they should be interacting, who's making the right choices for the government, who's making the wrong choices, all these things, justice, morals, what's right and wrong. We see a world that has all kinds of opinions. And what is the result of all these opinions? Chaos and hurt and suffering and division and anger. Where's the sanity? How can we come together? How can we know for sure what things should be? And the answer to that is in our Creator, the one who made these things. He knows the standard that we need to go by. He is the one where we get a sense of right and wrong, a true sense of justice and injustice, and how we need to live. He's the Creator who put all these things in place. And the reason they are out of place is that we don't know our Creator and how He's designed things to be. So God determines what is right and what is wrong and what is best for us as our creation. He knows what you and I need for our lives to flourish. Because He is the starting point of creation, He is the standard for creation. And so think about how this plays out in different ways in our life. How God is the standard for how we see things around us. First of all, think about beauty. When we look around us, I saw a picture from someone in our church this morning, a picture of the ocean. I think Pastor John had it. And you see the sun rising over the ocean. Wow, that's beautiful. And we're amazed at beauty, at the beauty of creation. And why is that? Well, it points to the fact that we have a beautiful Creator who made it. It shows us a glimpse of what beauty is. And we see that beauty, and our hearts should cry out, God, you are amazing. This is just a glimpse of who you are. You're so much greater and more beautiful than this. How majestic is your name in all the earth? Not how majestic is the earth. How majestic is your name in all the earth? What about justice? We have a desire for justice, for right and wrong. Pastor John mentioned that last week in his sermon. And why do we have a desire for justice, for right and wrong to be clear and clarified, and for punishment when somebody is guilty that brings about a healthier world? Well, we have a desire for justice because it also points to our Creator. Because humans believe in and want justice because God is just. He is always true. He is always right. His ways are perfect. And we long for a world where everyone's ways are perfect. Because that is how God has made us. And it goes back to who He is as our Creator. A desire for love points to a loving God. People believe in love. People want love in their life. Because God, the designer of all things, is love. And His creation has this in them. So every person who is here today has been designed to need and to know God at the center of your existence. Because God is the center of existence. The writer of Ecclesiastes puts it this way. God has written eternity on our hearts. God is the Creator who has written His eternity on our hearts. Pascal, the philosopher, put it like this. There is a God-sized hole in all of us. As His creation, there is a God-sized hole in all of us. And if we don't fill it with Him, we will find something to fill it with. Whether it's praise of men, or success, or money, or even alcohol, or drugs, or some other addiction, we will find something to fill our lives with that only God Himself can fill. Because He is our Creator. He has made us to know and acknowledge Him. When God is not in the right place in our life, You will feel that happiness is always just around the corner, but always just out of reach. I can never quite get there. There's something missing, something frustrating about my life, something unfulfilled. And that is the fact that God is not at the center of your life in some way. That's every person who is not a Christian feels this way. They're searching. That's going on that they have not found. For us who are Christians, we still wrestle with putting God in his rightful place all the time. But we know ultimately we have a conviction, a firm conviction that he is what we need. And we know it. We know him in a personal way. So the fact that God was in the beginning means that everything is from him. And everything is for him. All things exist for his glory. Everything goes back to him. And he deserves praise for all things. You, today, exist for God's glory. He made you. And you will be judged by how much you embrace that reality. How much you embrace the fact that God made you to know him and glorify him. If you embrace that, and know that Christ is the one who brings you to him, you will be embraced with open arms by God. But if you reject the fact that you have been made to know and worship God, God will reject you for rejecting him. So know that that invitation is to you today. A God who created you wants you to know him through Christ, the one who brings us to God. But to do this, to embrace God, to love him, to seek him, to follow him, and not our own desires, you need to be humble enough today to admit your need for God, the one who made you. Do you realize your life would not exist if God had not made you? Do you realize that you still need him today in all things? In all things. You need your Creator, even if you won't admit it. He is the one sustaining your life, even this moment, and holding all things together. God said this to Job. Job faced unimaginable hurt and pain. He had temptations to doubt God, to question God. And here's what God said to Job in Job 38. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Is there anything more humbling than that? Job, who thinks he has life figured out, who thinks he knows the answers to life, is confronted with the reality that God knows far more than he ever could. And he needs God. He needs God's answers for his life. And just as Job needs God, you and I need God. He has the knowledge and the wisdom that you and I lack, but he offers to us. So humbly today, see, your life is dependent on God and you need him in your life. He knows how he designed this world to work. He knows where you fit in this world and how you can have blessing and grace for him in the ins and outs of everything about this life. And we come to know his ways and his plans for our life as we come to know him. As we live in his presence, as we welcome him as our Lord and as our God. He shows himself and he shows us the path of life as we look to him. He will hold your life together. You will discover his will, his plans, and his purposes when you make him your Lord. And he is your Lord. But you have to admit that and serve him. So God was in the beginning. He sets the standard for life. He knows all things. He knows what we need. And we must admit that and look to him and admit we don't have the answers, but our Creator does because he made all things. So we see that, but then we also see here in this passage that God is revealed to us in creation. So much about who God is revealed in his creation. Look at verse 1 again. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That statement tells us several things about God. First, it tells us about God's power and might. There is a God who brought the universe into existence from nothing. Anybody else that powerful? Didn't think so. God is powerful beyond and above anything we can even imagine. Heavens and earth. When God created the heavens and earth, that refers to everything. All creation. He is omnipotent. All powerful. Nothing compares to Him. And since everything that exists and the universe is made by God, it is also under His control. The God who is powerful enough to make all things is powerful enough to control and rule over all things. He has the power to create, and He has the power to rule. And we, looking upon His power, must be in awe and must long for Him to intervene in our lives. Think about how weak we are, the mistakes we make, the sins we commit. God has power for those things. He's that powerful. This verse also tells us about God's wisdom. If God created all things, He knows how they were created, He knows why they were created, and how the world is meant to work. God is all wise. Which means that He has the wisdom you need for your life. The things you are facing, the decisions you have to make, conversations you need to have with people. God has wisdom for all those things because He made you and He made those things. So we need to run to Him and seek His wisdom. Third, it tells us about God's presence. God is not confined to a time or place. But He is over all of life. God's presence is everywhere because He created everything. And He is outside of time and space. In other words, if God is present in this way in your life, there is nothing that goes unseen by God or is too big for God to intervene and to address and to heal, to bring hope to. The God who created and is everywhere in all places and all times sees you, sees your need, and He can meet you there in that place and minister to you and work in your life. God's that big. Fourth, it tells us about what God deserves from us. Creation declares God's glory because creation came from God. Tells us how great He is. All the things that He has done. The beauty of who He is, as we already said. How great and weighty and mighty He is, so that we would marvel and glorify Him. The universe belongs to Him. He has the authority. He has rights of authority over all things that He's made, including you and your life. God has the right to be the authority in your life. He made you. Will you serve Him as your authority or something else? If you don't serve Him, if He is not your Lord, your King, you're serving the wrong King. He is the only one who knows how He has made you and how you need to live. He is the ultimate authority. The universe belongs to Him. God is before all else. And so it is foolish to put anything else above Him. He deserves first place because He was before creation. So we see all these things about God simply in this one verse. But then verse 2 also teaches us some more about our Creator God. Look at verse 2. Let's read that together. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness covered the surface of the watery depths, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Verse 2 here is referring to what things were like before creation. We notice that the Spirit of God was there, right? God was there before creation. We also see it's described as formless empty, dark. What we see here is a picture of emptiness and chaos. And we see that God is the one who brings order and definition to chaos and emptiness. Formless, empty, watery depths, all these things refer to chaos and emptiness. It's in need of God to organize. And how does that happen? Through the Spirit of God hovering over it. This supernatural wind filled with the power of God, the Spirit of God, third member of the Trinity. We already see a reference here in the second verse of the Bible to a triune God. Supernatural wind hovering over the surface of water, preparing to bring order to emptiness. Why did God do it this way? Why does God tell us this? It's to show us that He can bring order to our lives, to the chaos and emptiness of our lives. God, from the very beginning, brings order to all things, to emptiness. And He brings order and hope purpose to our lives. Our lives are formless and void until God comes in to bring life, and to bring peace, and to bring beauty and order. The God who created things to bring peace and beauty and order to the world brings those same things to our lives. God creates, sin decreates, and causes chaos. But God has the power to recreate us through Christ when He comes into our lives. Christ came to redeem us from the curse of the law, the sin that curses us and brings emptiness and chaos and separates us from God. Christ redeems and brings beauty and peace and order to our lives again. So think about your life. Does your life seem out of control? In some way, feel like your life is unraveled, unordered, empty. Sin has an unhealthy place in it. It's that affecting your life and your family and your well-being and your stability. Without God being central in your life, you are inviting this chaos and this emptiness to rule your life. But God is the one who helps us to see rightly. He's the one who helps us live our lives according to His good design. God knows what your priorities should be. He knows how you should order your priorities and how that will bring the most hope and health and happiness and joy and peace to your life. God knows how you should think about other people, how you should think about life in order to all that. King David knew this. Psalm 16:11. He says this to God: "You make known to me the path of life, the order of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." David knew that God knew the path that he needed to take to get him out of the emptiness, out of the chaos, into hope and peace and joy. God knows the path for your life. And He wants you to know Him so that He can reveal that to you as you seek Him and live in His presence moment by moment. It's not that just that you say, "Okay, God, you're my Lord," and God just says, "All right, here's the plan for the rest of your life. Just do these things." No, it's a moment by moment living with God and God saying, "Do this. God, what do I do? Do this. God, how do I respond? Respond like this," right? Through His Word, by His Spirit. God leads you moment by moment through this life. You know the path of life, and it's a step-by-step thing. So we see here that God is revealed, so much of God is revealed in His creation, and He wants us to know Him. First two verses of Genesis show us, you are made by God. That shows God's love and care for you. God made you. And He didn't have to. But God doesn't need you there either. He knows and sets the standards for your life. He wants you to know how He's made you to live. He brings life. and order to your emptiness and chaos. Because he made you, he wants you to know him. God doesn't just want you to know that he made you. He wants you to know him. Genesis 1 isn't primarily about the age of the earth, the length of days, science versus religion. Genesis 1 is primarily about God and us. Who God really is and who we really are. Genesis 1 was written to free us from wrong ideas about God, about why we exist, about sin that's in our life. There's a lot of debate today about science and creation. And yes, that is important. I don't want to minimize that. That is important. God is creator, and he, as creator, is the basis for all science. But don't get so hung up on the science debate that you miss this, that you miss that Genesis wants us to move from knowing, or moving beyond evidence for a maker to knowing him ourselves.
Amen.
God wants you to know him as our creator. And not just prove it, but to know it. To walk with him through life. And to know the creator who made you, who is with you. If there is a God who made the universe, we should not rest until we know him. There's a God who made me. I should not rest until I know everything I can about him, because he loves me. He knows what I need. He will lead me the way I need to go in this life. Earlier, we read from John 1, where John opens up his story of Jesus' life by connecting him directly to creation. Again, this is the picture of the Trinity, God, three in one, at work from the very beginning. Jesus re-enters a dark, sin-filled, chaotic world. That's what the world was like when Jesus came back, or came in the flesh, into this world, and he brings life and light to it again. In creation, God gives light. The world walks away from God into darkness. Jesus brings light again. Throughout his ministry, we see Jesus undoing all the chaos and the darkness left by sin. The world was chaos and darkness. God brought light into it. We went back in the chaos and darkness. God sends Jesus, his son, to bring light again. And he heals diseases. He opens blind eyes. He makes the lame walk. He walks on water. Wherever sin had left a dark void, Jesus speaks and says, "Let there be light." He forgives adulterers and thieves. He removes shame and transforms lives. Zacchaeus the thief becomes a generous man. Impure women become pillars of character and virtue. Jesus raises the dead. Jesus, the one through whom creation came, without sin, comes into the darkness so that we who rejected our Creator could have light and life again. Jesus allowed himself to be decreated on a cross so that we could be recreated by joining in his resurrection.
Amen.
Did you realize that the God who made you also wants to recreate you into who he made you to be, because your sin has taken you from him? Jesus makes all things new. So is your life affected by sin today in some way? A small sin even. A little untruthfulness, a little selfishness, a little greed, addiction, pride, family unraveling, your self-image distorted. You're in darkness in some way. If you turn to God, your Creator, by faith in Christ, he will make you new again. The Creator who made you, the Creator we see here in Genesis 1, also has the power to forgive your sin and remake you into who he made you to be, what your heart longs for. A person living in relationship with him, worshiping him, experiencing the blessings of his presence and the good gifts he gives, knowing that for anything in life, the God who made life is enough. For anything in life, the God who made life is enough. So God will bring life and light into the darkness, the sinful chaos of your life. And He overcomes that darkness one moment by moment. You put your faith in Him. And as you walk with Him, and as you love Him, and as you serve Him and know Him, will you let Him do that in your life? Will you walk in darkness when the Creator who brings life and light offers you His presence for your life? Let's look at this and be challenged that we need to know our Creator more. And Jesus loved us enough to reveal Him to us. Praise God for what He has done in giving us life, in offering us new life when we rejected Him. Let's pray together. Father, we thank You that You are a God who loves us enough to create us, but not just that, who loves us enough to give us life again when we walked away from the life you gave us, when we rejected You and pretended like we didn't need You in our life. You came to show us our sin more clearly, but the fact that You have a new life for us, just like You always intended. Lord, we praise You that Jesus has revealed these things to us. That the same Jesus through whom all things were created now offers His presence on the cross by His Spirit. Lord, we acknowledge today we need You. We don't have the answers for life, but You, as the author of life, have all answers. You are the only one who can bring order and hope and purpose to the emptiness of this life, to the chaos of this world. You are the only standard which will never change and which we can always go back to. It brings unity where there is division. Father, help us to look to You, to Your standard, to know You, and to know life. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to respond to God's word together. Today we have seen a picture of who God is. God invites you to live with Him, to know Him, to know how He is sufficient for your life. And that is the invitation that Jesus offers you. He went to the cross to forgive you of your sin so that you can know this God in a personal way. We would love to talk with you about that. We would love to introduce you to this God and help you to grow in relationship with Him. Let's stand and sing and respond to God's word together.
Great Thou art.
Serve the Lord through any way we can, including our time and our money, and we want to be faithful stewards of what He's given us. Also want to mention a couple announcements. We're excited tonight that the students, the middle school and high school ministry, is going to be gathering together for a kickoff. They're going to be meeting at Georgetown College in the quad, and just having a time to get to know one another. If you want to come, make sure you bring your Bible. We'll have a time of devotion tonight. But then each Sunday evening at 6:30, they'll be meeting outside for a time of Bible study, a lesson, and then breaking up into some discussion. And so we're excited about that. Invite your friends. I know a lot of students don't have a lot to do right now. Activities are canceled. School's not in session right now. And so this is a great opportunity to invite them and just to have some time together and looking to God and studying His Word together. So 6:30 of the night, Georgetown College. We hope middle schoolers and high schoolers can make that. Also on Wednesday, we are doing our outdoor prayer and praise service every Wednesday night, 6:30, just right around the side of the building. It's been just a sweet time to come together, to see one another, to pray together, to worship during the middle of the week, and just be reminded of who our God is, crying out to Him. So we hope you can come 6:30 on Wednesday to that. And as we close out, I want to read Psalm 90, verses 1 through 2. It says this: Lord, You have been our refuge in every generation. The God who created us has been our refuge in every generation. Before the mountains were born, before You gave birth to the earth and the world, from eternity to eternity, You are God. Amen. And so may we leave today worshiping the God who is from eternity to eternity, who is our refuge. And when we find refuge in Him, thank You for worshiping with us. If you join us online, thank you for joining us. We hope you all have a blessed week as we look to the God who loved us and who made us. Thanks.